Cool. By the way, I we'll talk about this when the show hits, which we are live. Somebody or I was I did another export this morning of something I was doing for SMS, and man, that the encode time with that new Premiere Pro patch, wow.
Awesome.
Ooh-wee.
A lot of people in my Twitter mentions were very, very happy about
Oh
it.
boy.
I'm interested, Adam, though, does it, I mean, what's the difference between, because they've had CUDA support, was it just simply
but
it wasn't using NV Ink?
the well I'm not quite sure on that, but the
The CUDA support did like effects and stuff for the
yeah
most
it
part,
was
right?
yeah it was mostly for like effects and overlays, plugins, you know, like certain things, not the actual full rendering. And I'll once again I'll bring it up in the show, but Puget Systems had a had an article about it showing the benchmarks and stuff, so I'll talk about that too. They found some interesting stuff.
Yeah, the one that they did during the beta, I linked in my article. They did some interesting, good work. They do good work over there. I like how they put it all out in the open.
By the
I
way,
like how too. Go ahead.
well, I was just gonna say we're live. We got Francesco, MB Dieter, Boria Zero, Blue Kid, Michael, Vignesh, Matthew. Everybody's here.
Oh, hey, we're live on Facebook today.
For Facebook and Twitter.
Oh, you reconnected them.
Yeah, I was just like, you know what? Forget about it. Why not? Why not?
No guarantees we'll be able to monitor all the comments, though.
No, I mean, usually there's not a ton, but luckily with this Restream software, you know, I forgot that it doesn't take any more system load on my end. It's all in the cloud.
Awesome. Thanks, other people's computers.
Yeah, renting server space somewhere else. Cool. Yeah, Gordon, what are we talking about today?
We are going to be talking about 10th gen Comet Lake S, of course. Reviews are up today. You can read ours at PCWorld.com. And of course, AMD is everybody's hero again. So stay tuned. Are we talking
Yeah,
about the NVIDIA
we'll
stuff?
see.
We're just going to work that in
Nope,
as a side
nope.
comment. No. I just want to point out, Adam, that didn't we do a video at Computex last year about how NVIDIA is going to fix Adobe? Hopefully, that was their plan.
Yeah.
And
I mean, I can probably comment on it maybe next week after I do some other rendering, you know. But I think, yeah, it's not like we're doing a formal review or anything. But I'll.
you know what I should do is just do some encodes and shoot them using using QuickSync as well as AMD's VCE, and then you can compare it to the CUDA as well as a software, you know, CPU encode and see what you think is best. That might be fun.
Yeah, there's definitely some fun stuff to do. We got Walls J, who said finally caught you guys live. Welcome, Walls J. And
Because
Will.
we're later than normal.
Yeah, I know this feels really
Yeah.
weird. I had to change my
Yeah, I
lighting,
know.
and I have my new camera, so I'm still trying to figure that out.
You don't look as pink this time,
Yeah.
though.
I'm a little flat, but you know, yeah, stuff to mess with. Anyway, cool. Yeah, I'm ready to go if you're ready to go, Gordon.
Yeah, let me get some water again.
Yeah, hydrate,
It
you
means
know.
vodka.
Actually, what was the kind of alcohol that Whoopi Goldberg served on in Star Trek?
She served many types.
Did
There's
she? I thought there
there's
was like
Saurian
one
and
thing.
brandy. Saurian brandy was the original sort of green drink, and then I think you have many other.
I think that's what I was thinking of, yeah.
There
Romulan
is
ale.
also
Romulan
Romulan
ale, yeah.
ale,
That stuff will get you messed up.
Aldebaran whiskey. I actually, the coolest thing about that I enjoyed about going to Comdex back when it existed was going to the Hyatt, and they had the full Star Trek experience there. It was awesome.
That's
They had
cool.
a bar that was shaped, it was built just like, you know, DS9's Quark's bar, and they had the, sorry.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah, those days are gone forever.
Gone forever. All right.
They scrapped that entire ride and some person rebuilt the whole thing in a warehouse. So
Interesting.
it's pretty cool. But more exciting than that, Comet Lake S. I know people want, you weren't, so there's some people here excited to talk about it, and then some people are here who just want to say bad things about it, because that's you, internet. We know you. That's what you're going to do. We ready to do this?
Sure.
Yeah, let's, I'm ready on my end. Let's do it.
Let me see if my mute button works so I can. All right, it works, but good. Ready? Oh, this is easy. There's only two topics. In this episode of The Full Nerd, Intel's Comet Lake S and AMD is your hero again. Insert music over here for the non-live version. Welcome to The Full Nerd, episode 140. I'm your host, Gordon Maung, with co-host Brad Charkas.
Hello, internet.
Elaine Yee is here, of course.
Hi, everyone.
And Adam Patrick Murray is controlling the horizontal and vertical.
I am actually really excited to render out this video after we're done, just to see how quick the new Premiere Pro update is with NV Ink support for H.264. So, yeah. I'm just here.
Does it only support H.264? We don't do HEVC?
It does HEVC too.
Yeah, yeah. In the past, the CUDA supported ProRes and things like that. So this is just a big gain for H.264, which is obviously a industry standard. But that's not a topic we're talking about here today. We're here to talk about CPUs, yep. Gordon.
You could use the CPU to render it out if you wanted to.
Which actually Pooja Systems did. We can get into their results a little bit later, but I want to hear about your results, Gordon.
Yeah, so we are going to kick this off with the heavily leaked 10th gen Comet Lake S. The craziest thing, of course, if you didn't see it, was the person wearing a mask, a dog mask, leaking everything a couple days ago. That really blew me away. Still, I do think it's worth talking about. We are going to kick this off with benchmark. We're going to kick this off with benchmark charts. We'll just go right into it. We're going to blip through this.
Just so you know, I put them up in with the numbers and the letters. So you just tell me what number or and or letter, or even the pictures that you gave me too. So,
and we're talking about the 10th gen 10900K for people who weren't aware what Comet Lake S means.
Yeah, it's 10th gen. It is still a 14 nanometer processor. It's the fifth 10-core, fifth 10th-core CPU Intel is built on a 14-nanometer process. It's much improved over the original, but we'll get into that later. Let's just kick this off with the first one. We're going to go with Cinebench, slide one, Adam. We'll go with slide one. We kick this off with Cinebench. R20. Multi-core support. Of course, this is Maxon Cinebench. It's built on a rendering engine from Cinema 4D. It's actually integrated into After Effects, some other Adobe products, and it is a 3D modeling program. It's updated to support AVX2, AVX512, all kinds of stuff advanced. It's very hard. Runs three times longer than the Cinebench R15, which you typically see. And the performance, we're going to cut a lot of the sort of multi-core performance here, but this is a feel for it. You have that Ryzen 9 3900X, 7161, 12 cores, 24 threads. Right after that is the Core i9 10900K, 10 cores, 20 threads, 6200. It is what it is. I think it's basically what I've been saying. And the performance, if AMD made a 10-core CPU, it probably would be right there with that Comet Lake S. And that's pretty much the multi-core performance. 12, by the way, is greater than 10. That's a simple math answer there.
And 10 is greater than 8, because this is the first Intel mainstream chip to have 10-core processors. That's not a high-end desktop, right?
Yeah, not a high-end desktop. So it's a small socket. It is a new socket, LGA1200, incompatible with the previous ones, because... I put in some historical tests. I will say the Ryzen 9, the Core i9 were run with the latest version of Windows, latest NVIDIA drivers, as well as latest BIOSes, all blah, 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 all mitigations in place. The other chips here for the 3950X, the Core i9, 8 cores are with previous BIOSes, different boards. But you still get a feel that, yes, you know, that 10 core, it is what it is. It's not 12 cores, but it's not 8 cores, right? It's 8. Mm-hmm. It's 2 more than 8. It's 2 less than 12. That's the basic math. We'll go on to the next one, slide 2, Cinebench R20. Single thread performance. Again, Cinebench takes 3 times longer to run than Cinebench R15. It uses all kinds of AVX2, AVX, AVX512, which is a little harder on Intel. Their clocks fall back a little bit. Their turbo boost doesn't pay off the dividends you would get out of, say, a lighter load, R15. I would say, essentially, these are dead on tie. I will say my numbers were a little less than some sanity check numbers I've seen. Not enough to really make a difference still. I mean, basically this is all the same. If you're buying these CPUs for single threaded performance on a heavy load, that's AVX 512, AVX 2, it's pretty much the same, right? Not a deal changer.
Well, as far as your numbers being a little lower in sanity check, it sounds like you need to have some pretty wild cooling for this to tame this beast. So I wouldn't be surprised if, even if you had, like, you had a Kraken, I believe, on here, water cooler. Yeah. If someone else had a different water cooler, it'd probably, you know, sway at those few points.
Yeah, you know, definitely it's 120 watt TDP part. Core i9 is a 95 watt TDP part. So it's definitely a hotter running chip. No surprise. That's one of the reasons why Intel apparently needed that new socket. They need more power to run this thing even. But, again, single core performance, not bad, good. But, you know, again, on a harsher load, it's pretty dead even with Ryzen. So you would expect Intel to have a lead, and it does have a lead, even sanity check, but it's not a huge game changer. So the next one we're going to do is a Corona renderer. And this is a non-biased photorealistic renderer. Even with 3D modeling, which loves threads and cores, there are some engines that like some CPUs more, and they may like other CPUs more. And you see Intel, that 10-core part in the Corona renderer, which I'm going to point out, is something that AMD originally brought to our attention back when the original Threadripper came out. Intel actually does pretty well in the Corona renderer. You know, you expect it to be a little bit slower, sort of halfway again between the 8 cores and the 12 core part. But it's essentially, what are we looking at?
More than halfway.
About 8%, right? Whereas with our Cinebench, it was about 15% slower, or Ryzen was about 15% faster. The Ryzen part's only about 8% faster here. So plus or minus, still faster is faster. Ryzen 12 core wins and is cheaper. We're not going to mention that till later. Next one, we're going to do a handbrake encode because essentially for all your 3D modeling loads, all your multi-core loving applications, 12 is more than 10, 10 is more than 8, and that's basically the math you're going to get. Some things are closer, some things are farther for that part. If you're really a 3D modeler, you're going to want more cores. Clearly, 12-core Ryzen, 16-core Ryzen are better picks than the 10-core part. No surprise. So, let's look at it in Handbrake. This is slide 3. For Handbrake, we use 1.3.1. We take 4K Tears of Steel, open source video. You can download it. And then we transcode it using the 1080p HEVC H.265 preset. 1080p, 30 frames a second. Shorter is better. Handbrake, the 12-core 3900X is faster than the 10-core. Looking at, what, about 16%? Sound familiar? Pretty close to that Ryzen R20. So again, 12 better than 10. And in pure thread load, when it's about 20% more threads on a 12-core Ryzen 3900.
Yep. But you mean the Intel chip is clocked a little bit higher, and just because a program uses more threads doesn't mean it uses them all evenly too. So you see a bit of a drop off, just like you do when you do multi-GPU gaming. There's a little bit of performance drop off the higher you go. So it's not surprising that's not a, you know, straight linear 20% gain for Ryzen and all this.
Right. And it never is. And people who think, hey, oh my gosh, I have a 16 core CPU, I'm going to get, you know, twice the performance of an 8 core. It often is not true. But again, Handbrake does like more cores. This is using the CPU to do the encoding, not the GPU. And 12 is better, right? Mm-hmm. Oops. The next one is slide 5. Unless I have this wrong, is it Topaz or did
yep,
I have
Topaz Sled 5?
So for this, this is kind of cool. This is made by Topaz Labs. It's their Video Enhance AI. This is a new version they just released a few days ago before I started testing. It uses Intel's OpenVINO to use AI to upscale video. For this, I tried to make it realistic. I took an old-fashioned flip cam style Kodak that I shot pictures, videos of my kids with 10 years ago or 8 years ago, 720p. I wanted to upscale it to 1080p using the Gaia HQ preset in Video Enhance AI. And again, this is not just simply, Adam can explain this to you. It's not a simple, you know, basic, you know, upscale where it doesn't look as good. This is actually frame by frame analysis using machine learning from what it's learned from looking at, you know, thousands of maybe millions of hours of other videos to make the picture look better frame by frame. It is a really, really long test to run. That's 232 minutes on that Ryzen 9. And I basically, for my testing, I was up to 5 o'clock in the morning. I started it at like, I think at 5 o'clock when I took a nap and then I came back, it was done. But, you know, in Topaz, OpenVINO performance, 5% for that Ryzen, still faster, but that Core i9 is pretty damn close, considering that it has 2 fewer cores, 4 fewer threads, and we are looking at 4 hours to run this encode. That means that CPU is running 4 hours to do this load, so a lot of the boost advantages the Core i9 might have don't really appear. So I think this is an indicator that obviously Intel's OpenVINO might run a little better on Intel hardware, but still 12 is better than 10 in the end.
Mm-hmm. Before we get to the next one real quick, Blue Kid gave us $2. Thank you so much, Blue Kid, and asks, how does one work for you guys in any capacity? You know, we have some labor proposals here.
Oh, it's above my pay grade, but
or maybe just mowing the lawn, like at the office or something.
There's so much greenery in San Francisco.
Yeah,
yeah. I don't know if we're going to be having an intern program anytime at this point.
Yeah, we'll see.
But
thank you anyway, Blue Kid. Appreciate it.
Yes, thank you.
All right, move on to the next one.
The last test is Synergy's CineScore. This is a benchmark that they make that's supposed to give you an idea of off-the-shelf computer performance for broadcast standard codecs. It's basically like, I don't know, 15 different resolutions and codecs all just slammed into one benchmark and runs entirely in memory, so it's not bound by a disk, which of course is a drive these days. Higher is better. It's very interesting because, again, we are pretty damn close. 2.4% advantage for Ryzen, but that Intel part is right there. This is, again, this is a benchmark that uses, I think, their own Daniel codec. It uses NVIDIA codec. It uses a few other codecs. There's SD, UHD. There's AK codecs tested all in this one thing, and you can get into the single scores, but I'm just going to give you the overall. And this pretty much tells you 3D modeling is sort of like the best case scenario for high core count. Video encode is not always as straight as more cores is better. And this is actually a good indicator that there may be times when Intel's, you know, architecture is better than AMD's or microarchitecture for codecs, because this again is somebody else's codec.
And it makes sense that, again, we're used to Ryzen being pretty hot the last few years since it came out. But Intel has been the go-to, you know, computer processors for years and years and years. So I wouldn't be surprised if there's just some, you know, with some of these optimization going on, it just works better on Intel CPUs as well.
Yeah. And then as much as people always want to say, you know, always buy Ryzen because it's better, generally, I would say still Ryzen is best for bang for buck and all that stuff, but you really need to look at what you're doing. If somebody tells you to buy a Ryzen and you buy a Ryzen and you run something that just loves Intel microarchitecture, you got steered the wrong way. So make sure you check out what you use first. Don't believe just what everybody tells you. There is no one answer that's right for everybody. We're going to go to slide 7-zip performance. I do have a WinRAR performance. I'm not going to show it. AMD sucks. It's actually a great example of some things that just run really poorly on AMD microarchitecture. RAR Labs, I don't know what's up, but if you use WinRAR and that's like your thing, you want an Intel part for it because AMD is just terrible on it according to their own benchmark. We are going to use 7-Zip though, which is free. I actually love 7-Zip. It's an awesome program. It's really fast.
I did an article about software with paying for a couple weeks ago, and most of the response I got back to it about missing programs was actually people going WinRAR, and I'm like, why are y'all using WinRAR? Is there something I'm missing? Go use 7-Zip.
Yeah, I mean, 7-Zip, WinRAR too, besides the fact that it runs badly, poorly on AMD, I don't think it's free, is it? You got to
pay No, you got to pay for WinRAR, yeah.
Yeah, 7-Zip, I'm like, you know, I would definitely say do 7-Zip over WinRAR. In my own case, I did do testing. You could read our story. Intel fans, go there, look at that WinRAR result. Send it to all your AMD friends just to make them angry. But 7-Zip, performance, multi-core test. Again, this is something that AMD traditionally, if this were a first-generation part, Intel probably would have cleaned their clocks in one of these. Multi-core performance, they're definitely beating Intel, period, no matter what. Sizable advantage. Let's look at it. 26% for the decompress and 45% for compress performance. So it's a huge win for AMD. You know, that's cache, that's out of order, that's memory latency. There's all kinds of things. There's different parts of it that it favors. Clearly, if you're running 7-Zip, AMD is the way to go. If you're on WinRAR, go Intel. But I also do like to do single core performance as well. And this does show you that Intel's advantage in clock speed does matter, because here it's not as huge, but you're looking at a 7.6% advantage for Intel in decompress and about 18% for compress. So there are times when that single core, single thread, light thread performance, Intel definitely has advantage of 1, 2, 3, 4 threads, and it's a good win there. But you know what? Intel didn't sell this CPU, market it anyway, as world's best multi-core performance CPU, because they know that is something they can't make that claim to, because clearly Ryzen is better. What they said was like, hey, we make the best gaming CPU. So the next chart, slide 9.
Which, before we even start, I have to mention, this is something that's bugged me for a long time. And we even got a comment on Discord. I think it was CauseMC had pinged me and said, oh, hey, let Gordon know that there's a typo in his article. It says 19 by 10 when I think he means 16 by 9. And I was like, oh, no, don't worry. Gordon doesn't... He replaces ratios with shorthand for resolutions, and it makes no sense. It really annoys the hell out of me.
Adam and I had this huge conversation about it the other day. It's one of the rare times I've ever heard Adam sound even slightly cranky.
I mean, it could have been the day, you know, quarantine gets to me.
It's because that's the way you do it.
No,
that's
there's plenty of other ways you can do it.
If you go back and you read video card reviews from the year 2003, nobody's going to be saying, oh, we tested this at
1920 by 1080. They're not going to say that.
They're not going to say.
They're not
going to
say 1920 by 1080.
They're not going to say 720p. They're not going to say FHD. They're not going to say 4K UHD. They're going to say 1920 by 1080 or 19 by 10 because everybody understands.
Well, one of those
19 by 10
one of those is right. The other one is a ratio. 16 by 9, 19 by 10 is a ratio.
Also, Gordon, 2003 was 15. No, wait. That was 17 years ago.
Here, let me tell you this.
Yeah, just because other people did it doesn't make it right.
That was
right?
17 years ago. It's a long time ago.
If this was good enough
those
for a non.
Can drive now.
Wait. If this was good enough for a non, if it was good enough for Kyle, the original Kyle, not the new Kyle, if this was good enough Kyle. For Thomas Pabst, it's good enough for you. Okay.
Sometimes you need to be able to stand up to the system and say, no, it's just wrong. And no, in this case, I'm saying, no, it's just wrong.
Should I say, what's better, 2160p or 4K 1080p. UHD plus?
1080p and 4K is what I use in my video card reviews.
Yeah, I mean,
why not FHD?
Either,
it's FHD,
yeah, either way, those are actual standards. 19 by 10 is not a standard. Nobody knows what that is other than, I guess, some, you know, PC reviewers online.
From the classic, where they used to do it, right? So you go tell the Mount Rushmore of hardware reviewers they were wrong.
I have no problem telling them that, and I'm sure they know that, though.
It has nothing to do with, like, them being wrong for the time that they were writing it. We're talking now in 2020, where sometimes, you know, language changes, conventions change.
If I went to four digits, I don't know why it would matter. I mean, you would know. You know, 19 by 10 is 1920 by 1080. It's just
no.
Actually, you had to explain that to me the first time you used it. So I do think it's easier just to put 1080p.
You know, if
or
if
FHD.
Kyle,
you know,
if Kyle is in there, he needs to drop a comment and just say that's just the way we should do it, man. In the comment section.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh,
but anyway,
well, we have
these are at 1080p.
These are 1080p. There are some things that are 1080p. You can see we note the abbreviated resolution because if I didn't, it would get too long and it would
Or you could just say
page.
FHD. That's actually shorter, but you know.
1080p.
Yeah.
I'm not going to buy into that FHD thing. It's just like, and then
I'm just saying, don't say you
FHD
did it for space. Don't say
FHD
you did it for
is
space.
Bad because people don't know FHD. FHD, people don't know those kinds of things. I like,
but at least it's
1080p.
A standard. You could Google FHD.
All right, hold up, everybody. We have Uncle Elias in Twitch chat who actually went back and found a 2007 Anantech article, and the charts use a lot of space to actually say things like 1280 by 1024, and there's actually spaces between the X's. So I mean, they weren't trying to skimp on space here.
Yeah, 2007 is not far enough.
You said 2003.
Okay.
2007 is just like, that's like now. Look.
Okay.
That's like
what,
now.
What's the resolution? Tell me what's the resolution of the Surface Book 3.
I mean, I can Google that. Do you want me to Google
it? It's a custom resolution that I would type out every bit of it.
Screen.
I'm just saying, when you make a chart and there's not enough room, you got to like find ways to cut stuff off.
Hold on. How many words were in this article, this review article? Were you really skimping? You're like, man, my editor says my word count's way too high.
No,
because well, this chart has a lot of info.
Look at
this
chart.
Has a lot of info.
I know,
when
but
you
this,
make the charts,
this chart, if he just said FHD, which is a standard you can Google, it's still shorter, right?
Well, what's 25 by 16?
1080p is the same thing.
Adam, what's 25 by 16?
25 by 16 is a ratio.
16 by 16, it's 1600p, right?
No, 25:16 is a ratio. That's how you usually write out ratios.
It's 25. Or,
here, let me Google
1600.
Let me Google 25 by 16 and see what.
What's
Google
19
says.
By 12? What's 19
Google
by
thinks
12,
I'm
Adam?
Just trying to do 19 by 12 is a ratio, right?
1900 I mean, by 1200.
4 by 3, 16 by 9, 2.35 by 1. You know, these are all resolutions that you're saying.
Nobody does it that way.
Nobody does it that way?
Nobody
does it
that way. Except for 2007 Anantech, which apparently then doesn't fall under a qualification or doesn't qualify to you because it's not old enough. I don't know about this logic, Gordon.
Adam is basically trying to delay it as much as possible because he knows this is the
It's just something I've just been sitting on for a while, you know. And then Kaz MC riled me up in Discord. We can get to the chart for
Comet Lake S, and you're trying to derail it, Adam.
Is it the shining point?
Intel came out. Yes, it is, because Intel came out. And they said this is the world's best gaming processor, and it is clearly because it is faster. Again, this is what I don't even know how many 16 different resolutions and settings and tests. Plus, there's some other tests. I didn't even include some other things in here. The only bar where the red is longer is the bar where shorter is better. So we can go down the whole list, but there's nothing that I ran practically, not on this list anyway, where Intel wasn't faster in gaming. Might not be enough to change your mind, but like Far Cry New Dawn, which I've never run before, but it was interesting because Far Cry 5 happens to suck wind on AMD, right? Mm-hmm. An Ultra at 25 by 14, which is, for people who don't know, 2560 by 1400 resolution, about 9%.
You're killing me. I'm trying not to weigh in on this, but you're killing me, Gordon.
19 by 10, 7.5%, 19 by 10, normal. So again, we are cranking the game setting to a lower setting, so it's not as GPU limited. Practically 14% faster than the AMD part. Pretty solid win. And again, this engine in the past is not like Ryzen, and we sort of see that here. Wait, why am I killing you, Brad?
25 by 14. Like, I was just letting the 19 by 10 go, but 25 by 14, it just, I don't know why, it was just killing my brain.
That's where Brad puts his foot down.
1440p. If I put 1440p, how would that?
1440p, people would be like, oh, 1440p. Yeah,
should I only list?
It's a standard.
If I said 1200p, would you know what that is?
No, if I was doing an off resolution like that, not a standard resolution, I would spell it all out.
Yeah, but so then I know what. So I know I do some at 1200p or some at 1080p, and then some at like then some are 1920 by 1200p. That's just
If you do 1080p, it's pretty much always 1920 by 1080p, right? If it's ultra wide and the and it's 1080p, then you still want to list out the width and the height because it's not the same.
Okay, I agree. Ashes of the Singularity at 1920 by 1080p, 7.5%. This is doing the crazy preset, and I also tend to use their CPU focus because supposedly years ago they told me they throw more units at the screen. You're sort of measuring the impact of more units in a real-time strategy game. Should be more of a load, and Intel has about 7.5% load lead. Chernobyl Light, both of these at 1080p, 1920 by 1080. FHD is 7.9% on high. Again, less of a GPU load. About 2.6% on ultra. Both of those in favor of Intel. Civ 6, Gathering Dawn. This is a fairly new version or expansion pack for Civ 6. This is the only looking at AI, how long it measures. It takes for the computer to do its move after you submitted its move. And about 6.5% for Core i9, 10th gen. Metro Exodus, a little bit of a surprise here because Extreme, obviously you're very GPU bound, 3% advantage for Intel. RTX, which I thought would actually be even worse, only about 4.3%. And then on high at 1920 by 1080, 19 by 10, FHD is 6.7%. So it's still very, very heavy GPU bound game. But again, Intel's still faster. Quake 2 RTX, fully path traced, which is probably of all the ray tracing tests I've run, is probably harsher than any of them. About 2.7% faster for Intel. Practically within the margin of error, but still the margin, it leans towards Intel. And it is RTX, That's fully path trace. I was quite surprised. That's at 19 by 10, 1920 by 1080 FHD. Also Red Dead Redemption 2, 19 by 10 Ultra, which should be a very much GPU bound setting. In Vulkan, about 4% for Intel, you know, decent. And
I still need to play that.
Still need to play it. And again, you know, you're not seeing anything that is leaning toward AMD. Just about everything is going to lean toward Intel. It is mostly single digits. So some people might say, well, that's not a lot here. I mean, obviously Far Cry is better on Intel. Last one I'm going to close with is Gears of War and Gears of War 5.
That one surprised me.
Yeah. On Ultra at 25 by 16, 2560 by 1600p. It's 6.2% for Intel. On Ultra at 19 by 12, which is FHD plus or 1200p. It's 17.2% for Intel. Moving to medium, of course, which we're very much not GPU bound in the benchmark. Apparently the that test is very, very tough, but I'm going to guess at medium, you're not bound by the 2080 Ti that I use for all these tests. And you're looking at a 48.8% advantage for that Core i9. And there's also a CPU frame rate, which I thought would have been higher, but still 35% for Intel, which is, I'm going to guess Gears of War 5 is that's what we'd be rendering at if the GPU wasn't the bottleneck in all our performance. So pretty much solid win for gaming. There's a couple things I do want to mention. I was surprised that AMD won at. One is CSGO. I was actually quite surprised. They were both over 400%, but I thought that Intel part would be faster. It wasn't, quite surprisingly. I still have to sort of look at that to see why, because Core i9 was faster than 3900, the 9900KS. And also, of course, 3DMark Times by Extreme, the CPU test, which is physics-based, the AMD part has an advantage over it. Not huge, but an advantage. I don't fully believe in that because I'm of the belief that most games are not using all of the thread count that's available. Yeah. So, but I do want to mention that so people don't think I'm you know, leaving stuff out.
To me, these numbers are interesting because it's clear, again, that Intel has the performance lead, which it did with the 9900K too, just to a lesser degree. But looking at these, again, I think I stressed this when we did the 9900K review, or maybe it was the 3900X review. In the resolutions that people actually play at, it's going to be negligible. Because if you have a 10900K and a 2080 Ti, you're probably not playing a 1080p, which is where you're going to see these bigger gulps, which are still, for the most part, Gears of War being different is, you know, 4 to 6%, which is definitely an advantage, especially if you're playing in esports. But, I mean, 4 to 6%, the 3900X is $100 cheaper.
Comes to the cooler.
Yeah. And when you, another scenario where it might make a difference is like if you plan on getting one of these high end gaming CPUs and playing it like 1440p or 4K with next gen, like big Navi or 3080 Ti, you might see this, you know, make more of a difference. But keep in mind what you're looking at here. It's not really a huge difference in the resolutions right here that we're looking at. Like in your real world, you're not going to play like this, most likely.
Well, again, if you're esports and you play on a 300 hertz panel, 500 yeah. hertz is coming around. Yep. So
that being a very big exception, you know, the esports yeah. can,
yeah,
is his own thing.
Yeah. And I would agree because I think as you get up to 1440p or 2560 by 1440, whatever that is that UHD minus? I don't know what that is, but you get there. I mean, you're not going to see a huge difference between a 3900X and a 10900K in gaming.
Yep.
Unless you have
a game that's just because it's your graphics card sweating for the most part. So.
Right. But, you know, we don't know what 3080 Ti is going to bring. We don't know what Big Navi is going to bring. If it's a quantum leap forward in performance in non-ray trace games, you're
going to
want
make a difference.
You're probably going to want an Intel part, I think. That'd be my recommendation. There are a lot of caveats with both, you know, with that go with that, of course.
Yep.
One is cost, obviously, because it's not really, it's not that cheap. We can go to the bucks per thread chart. This is a pretty big one. I think I did call out at least all of the, I took out the high-end desktop parts.
This is what chat was waiting for. There's always people waiting for the bucks per thread chart, even though it's a little hard to read now, but yeah.
I know. I didn't know what to take out, you know, and I had to add street pricing because I do have street pricing and I do have MSRP trade pricing, you know, 1KU pricing in there. Intel the last few years has tended to exceed 1KU pricing, whereas it used to be eventually it would get lower than 1KU. 1,000 units is what 1KU means. AMD is solidly below MSRP these days, so you have to acknowledge the price advantage, right? We should let Elena talk about this because she could that's her jam, you know.
Well, the thing to keep in mind too is not only are Ryzen chips significantly below MSRP today, at least I was checking right before the show. I'm assuming you used the $488 price for this for the 10900K. But actually, if you go look at e-tailers, at Newegg, it is $600. At B&H, it is $530. Or it might be vice versa. But it's $530 is the cheapest I could find it. Just to throw that out there. It's the part. That tends to happen.
That tends to happen. But I think the thing that's a little disheartening about that for somebody who was like, well, it'll settle down. It doesn't, because look, I also included the street price of a Core i9 9900K, and it's not lower, I don't think. Let's see, where is that 900K?
No, it's been high. It's been out of stock or high. Yeah.
Yeah, for a while now.
And the crazy thing though is I was like, well, what about the 9900KS? He's like, well, should I even include the 9900KS in the testing? It's like, I realized that basically that part has basically vanished because I could only find it for $1,500 for that KS part. And it's really just, it's really expensive per thread, which if people who are new to the bucks per thread, it's basically where we take the total amount of threads you are paying for the CPU. It doesn't impart performance necessarily, but if you are shopping for more threads because you are a 3D renderer and you want more threads because you like the idea, this chart does give you an idea of what's the better value. All that said, I will say the street price of the Core i9, Intel did a lot of things right, because that 10900K, if it ever does get to the $488, which is on this chart, it's about $24 per thread, which isn't that far from the MSRP of a 3900, right? Which is $21. So $21 per thread versus $24 is not bad. It's not bad.
It's like the first time I think we've really, not the first time, but I think it's starting to show that AMD has put enough pressure on Intel that we're getting more parity between that kind of core thread or cost per thread analysis that you're doing. Before, if you look at some of the older parts on that chart, man, it's just like, just shoots like straight to the right there. It's kind of intense.
Yeah, no, it's really, I mean, some of the value is absolutely horrible. Like look at the Core i5 9400F. Which, you know, heck, that's, I think it's like six cores, six threads, no hyper-threading. That part gets replaced by, so arguably, I mean, there's a K part, but Core i5 10600K, you're getting six threads, six cores, 12 threads. It's actually almost reasonable for Intel compared to what a previous K part was, right?
I like that you have that caveat, though, like it's for Intel. And I do think that, I think that's something that's worth pointing out, just because we were talking about comparing the 10900K. Oh gosh, it's going to take a while for me to get used to that.
Yeah.
To the 3900 street price. And here's the thing though, like if AMD holds true to form, that street price is only going to get lower during sale periods.
Right.
Intel is going to, the best you're going to see is like maybe a $30 to $50 drop below MSRP, when that's even a possibility. But maybe not, because as you were just pointing out, a lot of the high-end parts these days have not really been available in enough quantity to encourage anybody to sell it at a lower price.
Right. So that's what's kind of killed them, right?
Yeah, it's not going to be this thing where it's like, okay, well, they're kind of starting off roughly in the same area. And right now, the rise in parts lower because it's been out longer. You know, they have had more time to put, you know, stock into the channels. But it's not necessarily going to reach parity even in that regard, because Intel's always kind of run things differently. So I think that anyone looking at this proposition and thinking, well, maybe I could wait for it to go on sale, that's not going to really happen. You're going to just have to choose if you're going to shell out the more money for Intel or if you want to go the AMD route.
I mean, yeah, look at that. So this is a horrible, this is sort of that problem, right? I was just Core i7, 9700K, 8 cores, no hyper-threading, $48 per thread, right?
I'm really glad this chart is making me think of it, that only lasted for one generation. For whatever reason, maybe for security reasons, the last generation, maybe it was for product segmentation reasons, and they realized they messed up. There were no hyper-threading for 9th-gen desktop parts, and that was a big mistake. I hated it. The second I saw it, that wasn't the way to fight against Intel. Now, all these chips have hyper-threading again, which is great. It makes a huge difference in value proposition.
Yeah, because look, you can see, $48 per thread, to that Core i7 10700K, which, hey, they switch on hyperthreading, yay, and which you now get to $23 per thread. Now, I know people are like, well, what is this? This is a crazy metric, but you know what? If you run Cinebench, if you run Corona, you run all this modeling, V-Ray, all that stuff, hyperthreading gets you a significant amount of performance that you're now getting that Intel wasn't giving before. So that's as much as people are good, a lot of people here to sort of like bag on Intel. Intel has made the right move with these 10th gen parts. And I think like even the 10900K, for all its warts, it's not faster than a 3900X. It's not cheaper. But it isn't a bad part, because the 9900K didn't deserve to be in the same room with the 3900X. It didn't deserve to be priced more than 3900X. This part, at least, you know, you're getting somewhat compatible multi-core performance. You're still getting outstanding single core, you know, two core, that sort of gaming advantage. So, you know, I think it's better. You know, it's a solid part. People may want to just kind of like, oh, dismiss it. But this is a very solid part for Intel. I mean, it's way better than the 9th gen situation, it feels like.
Yeah, this is definitely Intel doing the best it can with its fifth year of 14 nanometer. I mean, they really got it humming. Yeah, it was kind of a smack talk, but I mean, this is really them doing what they can. I mean, I mean, it's fast. They've definitely got this thing humming. They got more cores than ever. I mean, it's not going to blow anybody's socks off, but I have no complaints about what this is.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't
it's
be
a
like
a big improvement over 9th gen, like you were saying.
Yeah, yeah. No, I agree, because I mean, 9900K was like, you really had to like, they had been boxed into such a tight corner, like, well, if you play esports with a 2080 Ti.
Yeah.
But I was like, other than that, why would you ever buy this part? This is like, you know, I want solid game performance. I don't care quite as much about multi-core, you know, and I'm going to deal with it. You know, it is what it is. We said that a couple weeks ago, right? It is what it is. It's not bad. So,
and now that the part we're going to talk about later, AM4 coming to a switchover, AMD's upgrade proposition is an advantage over Intel, because you could expect to get one or two generations of upgrades out of both of these motherboard chipsets. So,
yeah. Oh, actually, let's show the last one. I do like this 11, the next slide 11. It's kind of fun, because I hadn't even looked at it this way till I was like, oh, I need to pull stuff off this chart. But let's put them actually all into one chart. This is essentially a chart of how much Intel has charged per thread for all of its 10 core consumer core processors. And it really is sort of like, it was the height of Intel hubris. It was the famed 2016 Core i7 6950X Broadwell E part. It was a big socket part, 10 cores, 20 threads, $86 per thread. It was 1,723. I remember it because it was hard to, that's one thing you will always remember. It's like $1,723 for 10 cores.
At when the 8-core chip was $1,000. Mm-hmm. I every time that part number gets brought up, you might have just seen it. I just automatically sneer. That year when we did our full Nerd Hardware Awards, rather than give the first 10 core chip an award, we voted no winner for CPU because that pricing was ridiculous.
I did vote for it because I still think you reach for the gold. But I mean, the crazy thing is, look at that, was 2016. We get to 2017. Core i9 7900X Skylake X, 10 core, 20 threads. Believe me, that Skylake X launch was no fun at the time. I didn't look at the 10 core part, but it was $49 per thread. Significant decrease from $86 per thread. Still really not enough to sort of like fight off Threadripper and, yep, and Core i9. We get to 2018. These are all big socket parts. You get the Core i9 9900X Skylake X, 10 core, 20 thread. Big difference. They went from a paste thermal interface to a solder thermal interface. Big deal. Same price though, $49. And then of course, last year, after 3 years of just getting beat on by AMD's high core count parts, AMD or Intel finally slashed prices. 2019 Core i9 10900X Cascade Lake X, $30 per thread. That's a huge move, right? It was like $580.
That was the point where you and I were talking on one of the Full Nerds about how they had done this huge price cut, really.
Yeah.
Right? Because it was so dramatic for them to drop it by that much.
Yeah. And of course, now we get this year's Core i9 10900K for $24 per thread. Slightly more than AMD. And, you know, it's actually, at least it's in the ballpark, right? So at least it's in the ballpark. So that, I think that's, this people need to recognize, this is the big ship turning around and Intel saying, we're at least going to finally compete somewhat. So
this just drives home the ridiculousness of Intel naming to me even further beyond the whole trying to say something like 10900K. The fact that they have a 10 core 10900K, a 10 core 10900X, they have a 9900X, they have a 9900K. It's like, oh my. This is why I always have to look stuff up before I say anything on the show.
I know.
You know, the really bad thing too is from Broadwell E to Comalink S, it's 14 nanometer. Every single part is 14 nanometer. That is a long time to be stuck on a process. And that has been the thing that has just been Intel's curse, is not being able to get off 14 nanometer for desktop parts. So
that's what tick tock it would have been back in the day.
Yeah.
Before we get off this topic, we do have some questions rounding out your review. Or earlier somebody was asking, did you get a chance to test any of the lower end parts like the 10700K or anything like that?
I did not, because I was very interested in I was sort of interested in the high end part because that goes against AMD's sort of, you know, high end parts. I do think it's a solid battle there. I really need to get back in there and look at the i5. That i5 10600K is a pretty solid part, right? You're looking at because you're looking at 6 cores, 12 threads, obviously power is going to be up there, but you're looking at a base clock of 4.1 gigahertz up to 4.8 turbo. And where is it in cost? $22 per thread. Not bad. You're looking at, if you're putting that up against the Ryzen 5 3600, $21. Of course, 3600X on the street is about $17 now. So still... But you're looking at 6 core, 6 threads. At that, you know, similar core count, similar thread count, the battle is not going to be at that disadvantage that the i9 10900K is. So I think it might be a lot closer. The issues, of course, would be thermals and power. And, you know, AMD gives you a cooler that will at least run at stock speeds just fine. Whereas Intel, I'm not sure you will be able to run at stock speeds with a Intel cooler.
Yeah, and that was some of the other questions was about thermals and power. We've heard it loses a lot of power. We've heard it's hot. What about your scenario, Gordon?
Yeah, so I didn't get a chance to look at thermals. You know, my feeling is unless you're thermally throttling, and again, you saw the result of running Topaz and Video Enhance for 4 hours straight. That's a pure CPU encode or AI. I don't think I, and it was pretty damn close to that Ryzen part. I don't think the thermals were enough to hurt performance. Again, I was running a Kraken X62 on both of them, 100% fans with the fan blowing into an open case. But you want that for an ideal situation. What would be interesting is that cost advantage, whereas 3900X with a stock cooler versus a 10900K with an aftermarket water cooler.
Yeah. You're adding more to the cost, right? I was reading other site reviews as well, and like Ian Anantek said that he knows somebody who had issues troubling the cooling the 10900K with a Corsair H115i, like, which is a liquid cooler. And Paul over at Tom said that the high power consumption from the 10900K, you know, it was given their 280 millimeter water cooling rig some issues sometimes. So it sounds like if you want to actually try to get those 5 to 5.3 gigahertz speeds with this, you're going to need to like invest some serious, like $100+ in a cooler.
Yeah. And I actually used to use Corsair H115's eyes for testing, and I had to move on because we've been beyond those for even the Ryzen parts.
Yep.
So, Elena?
Well, kind of piggybacking on Adam here, Twitch chat also is pointing out that kind of a counterpoint to you and Brad saying that, you know, Intel's made these great strides. They're saying that, you know, it's only insofar as much as they could, you know, given that they're still stuck on 14 nanometer, I presume is what Uncle Elias on Twitch was saying, that they made the right moves, but it is more expensive. It runs hotter, draws more power, and requires more expensive cooling. And for most workflows, it's slower. And so because of that, the pricing compared to Ryzen is still not where it needs to be competitive, in their opinion.
No, I agree with you. Intel's just stuck because, you know, if 14 nanometer parts were falling off trees, they would have gone a price war. I'm sure Intel would have gone a price war with AMD, but they just can't because they can't make enough to cut the prices on them and go to a price war. So yeah, but you know, again, it's solid. 10th gen, these parts are solid. There's definitely caveats to buying them, but you know, you shouldn't feel horrible. As far as power, we do have a slide C, Adam, if you want to show that. It's kind of interesting. Although I'm going to point out weaknesses with it because I don't have matching power supplies. I use 1,000 watt power supplies in both of these. One was 80 plus gold. One was 80 plus silver. And that's, I think, at 20% load by 80 plus, that's about a 2% difference in efficiency. The Intel part had the 80 plus gold. The Ryzen had the 80 plus silver. So it's at a disadvantage on power. I basically ran a Cinebench. God, I can't remember. I'm sure it was 15, not 20, because 20 would have just taken too long. And I ran them on both systems at the same time, measuring power draw at the socket. There were no fans running in the case, although the motherboards all had their crazy, you know, little OLEDs and their little lights and LEDs and all that stuff. But it was same GPU, same amount of RAM. LEDs I really couldn't control. Interestingly, the Intel part had a decent power savings on very light loads, 1, 2, 3, 4. As you moved up to about, you know, heavier 4, 5 threads, 6 threads, the Intel part just starts ramping up to significantly more power than the Ryzen, as you can see. I stopped running it on the Intel part after a certain amount because there's no need to run Cinebench R15 with 18 threads because it's a, or, you know, 22 threads because it stops at 20. The next chart too, actually the last, hopefully we're going to show off, is the same thing. This is Cinebench R20. Same, it run exactly the same thing. This is slide D. Same load on both systems, exactly the same time within, you know, a second. The red is the Intel 10900K. The purple is the Ryzen 3900X. As you can see, the Intel part is using almost 290 watts. This is just a CPU load in Cinebench R20. And not only is it using about 30 more watts at the socket. It takes longer too, but you also have to consider the additional time it takes to run that load. Definitely, if you're in a place that you need to conserve power, Ryzen is the way to go. And that's with Intel having the advantage of an 80 plus gold power supply. If I had matching ones, I'll do it again. It's more scientific, but clearly 10900K uses more power.
Okay.
They both use a lot of power. 10900K definitely uses a lot of power too.
That's the other thing. It's not like Ryzen 3900X. Like, oh yeah, it's a laptop. I'm using 20 watts.
Yeah.
You're up over 200. You're about 250 watts. So This is, sometimes it feels like people make a little too much out of that. I mean, especially you think about you're cranking your CPU at 250 watts and then your video card's using 250 watts. What do you, 5 or 10% more is not, is it going to make a deal breaker?
Oh. For me, I've talked about this before. The power is not so much a deal breaker because, again, once it's plugged into my wall, I don't really care. For me, we haven't really talked about it, but the lack of PCIe 4.0 support on these new motherboards is the big deal breaker for me. Yeah. Because those SSDs are a whole lot faster. And even though we're still in the first gen, they're only going to get faster as new controllers come out. And that's something that I really want to, from building a high-end enthusiast system today. I want that specific upgrade path available to me. I don't want to be buying PCIe 3.0 when I know PCIe 4.0 is here and has been here for 3/4 of a year. And to me, that's a major disadvantage for Intel at this point. I was really disappointed that they weren't able to get that in here, especially because all the motherboard makers are making it sound like next gen Rocket Lake S chips are definitely going to have PCIe 4. So that's a bigger consideration for me than power draw.
Yeah, I don't know how they're going to do that, because it's going to be a bummer when you look at those. Yeah, those second gen PCIe SSDs, they're probably going to scream like.
Yep. Right? Yeah, I'm holding out for those. I'm looking forward to them.
They might even be faster than what you're getting out of a console. And then, what are you going to do then?
One last thing on my end. Big Al over on Discord had put in our questions channel. They watched Gamers Nexus and Hardware in Box this morning, and they both mentioned that the Z490 has all kinds of BIOS issues. Did you run into any of those in your testing, Gordon?
I don't know what boards they had. I didn't have issues. I will say there are things there I couldn't find. I know that supposedly there's PCIe overclocking. But, motherboard BIOSes these days, they're like, it's like trying to find your way through a phone tree of the federal government. You're going to be there for hours just looking for something, right? It's just very hard to find. I also, interestingly, so you have the favored cores. So one of the features with 10900K or the 10 series is now you have favored cores. Basically, at the factory, they look at these two cores on each individual die. These are the ones that are going to run the fastest, and we'll tell you which ones they are. I didn't see that in the BIOS with Core X parts. They used to give you an asterisk to tell you which one. I tried too early, but I couldn't find XGU didn't either. So I don't know. It's a little rushed. It's not quite complete in that, but I didn't have crashing. I didn't have craziness. So I'm not surprised. Intel, when they are under a harsh schedule, plus also, there's this thing going on in the world right now, so it's a little hard to qualify everything and make everything work. So you almost kind of think you kind of give them a little bit of slack for that because,
I mean, that's part of the reason why our own tests, like you said, you have some of the historical data in there for some of the other parts, but you didn't retest them. It's because, considerations from all this going on. So, yeah, it's good to have grace with everybody, I think.
Yeah.
Speaking of grace, should we give AMD grace for their reversal on the AM4 decision?
I will.
Sure. Yeah.
I'm bummed. I had all these lines saved up because I was anticipating just making fun of them because, obviously it'd be fun just to, there's so many lines you can use.
Really?
Well, there's the Batman one. You either die a hero or live long enough to become the villain, right? That was like perfect.
Well, now they continue to live on, so yeah.
Well, another one, of course, was Godfather 2,
please.
Michael Corleone, please, his brother. You know this, Adam.
It's been a while since I've seen the second one.
You broke my heart, Fredo. You broke my heart. I know it was you, right? That's just like.
Okay. Yeah. Nice.
So it's weird because I actually expected both of you to have more of a stronger reaction to the news, but
why?
You guys just seem to be like, yeah, that's cool.
Somebody should break it down first.
I think it's great news.
I think it's great.
Yeah, I think it's wonderful personally. So I wrote the article on it, so I guess I'll break it down. So basically, we covered it last week. We spent like half an hour talking about what a crap move it was. AMD drew a line in the sand and said, hey, B450 boards, X470 boards aren't going to be supporting future generations of Ryzen chips, Zen 3 chips, Ryzen 4000 in the future. Despite, you know, saying from the beginning AM4 socket is going to be supported through 2020, leading people to believe that they were cutting off older chipsets while still technically saying they were supporting AM4. So it was kind of a bait and switch kind of scenario in my brain. Not illegal. You know, not being a lawyer, that's not legal. But anyway, the internet agreed, you know, plenty of other tech publications and YouTubers talked about it. It blew up in forums. Fortunately, AMD actually listened to the feedback, and they're now saying that they will make optional BIOS upgrades available for B450 and X470 motherboards. It's a compromise. It really is a compromise. Because there are very real technical reasons why they were saying, hey, we're going to cut this off here. So it's much more complicated than previous BIOS updates, but they are going to make these B450 and X470 BIOS updates for Zen 3. So Ryzen 4000, presumably, or 5, whatever the next Ryzen chips are going to be called, for B450 and X570 motherboards. They're going to be optional. They're going to give the code to motherboard makers. Motherboard makers will have the option to offer it.
Yep.
It won't be mandatory. It's a one-way trip, so if you upgrade to it, you won't be able to flash back to your older BIOS. They're only going to offer it if you somehow verify that you have one of these motherboards and a new Zen 3 chip. It's complicated, but they're meeting people in the middle and trying to do what they can to get this in the hands of the enthusiasts who are rightfully, in my opinion, causing a ruckus over this. So I'm glad to see them go, you know, we weren't thinking about it like that. We hear you all. We're going to try to meet you in the middle as much as we can. They don't have all the hard details available yet. Right. One thing, Zen 3 is not going to be around for probably several months. And for another thing, it sounds like they were just like, yeah, we hadn't really thought about this. Listening to y'all, we want to do it. Give us time, we'll figure out the exact thing, and we'll come back and give you more info. But yeah, so there you had a change of heart after everyone complained, which is really good. Hopefully it doesn't open a can of worms like BioWare did when it changed the end into Mass Effect. But it's good to hear, to see AMD listening to very valid feedback that, hey, this is kind of not cool what you're doing, and coming back and saying, okay, we're going to try to meet you halfway as much as we can. So good.
Yeah, I think that part is definitely the part that makes me happy, to see that they acknowledged a lot of the criticism, the valid criticism, and all the feedback that they got. The part that I'm going to be really interested in seeing, like, what the developments are in the next couple of months before the launch of Ryzen 4000, is how they're going to thread that needle between making people who wanted to do upgrades happy versus the people who were hoping to get more of a, to save some money, really, by getting an older board with the newer chip. Because one of the things that has come up already is people asking about boot kits, just because those boards won't be coming with the BIOS update already installed. I think it's like, it's something you have to actively seek. And so it's not going to be ready right out of the box if you try to drop a Zen 3 part into it. So I wonder if they're going to just ignore that population, or if they're going to come up with some workaround as well. Because I think it was Steve over at Gamers Nexus was pointing out that it's expensive to run a boot kit program, and some of those ships just don't come back. So I don't know if
For people who don't know, they would send you a CPU to do your upgrade, and then people just wouldn't send them back, right?
Yeah.
Actually, you're supposed to be a good citizen to send it back.
They're not even really high-end chips either. They're just enough to get you, like, into a state where you can actually run a BIOS update, and that's it.
And the thing is, these new to make room for all these new Zen 3 chips, they're going to have to get rid of a bunch of older support for a bunch of older, lesser used chips like that. And so those boot chip style devices are probably going to get chucked out the window. So one of the things that they said is that their intent is to offer BIOS download only to verified customers of 400 series motherboards who have purchased a new desktop processor with Zen 3. And that'll ensure that customers have a bootable processor on hand after the BIOS flash. So my guess is you're going to have to already have a chip in a motherboard and say, hey, I'm upgrading this. Not necessarily that, I've been stashing this B450 motherboard for a year to wait for this. I don't expect them to send out boot kits just by the verbiage of all that. So I think this is a pure play for people who already bought it, enthusiasts who want to actually upgrade and weren't just stashing parts. That's my guess, looking between the lines here of what's going to happen. Which, again, this is a very small subset of enthusiast users who are a subset to begin with. So I'm not upset about it. They're doing the best they can. But yeah, it's I don't expect boot kits.
Well, I've seen some people, say, could this in the long run lead to some consequences that we're not thinking of? What are those consequences?
Gordon is nodding
They're not
emphatically.
gonna promise something like what they did with AM4 again. They're gonna be much more specific in their marketing language, I think, because I think that's the big lesson from all of this, is that they said, hey, we're gonna do all this. And then again, just ditching older chipsets like we were discussing last week stays to the letter of the promise, but ditches the spirit of the promise. And I think they're going to manage those expectations much more going forward, especially now that Ryzen is a hit and people are looking to buy it. It was kind of when it first came out, we're going to have this through 2020. AM4, that's what you're going to be able to upgrade. That was a big promise back then when they're trying to get this new part, this new brand, off the launching pad. Now they're established. This is rearing its head, and this is going to cost them resources, like maintaining all this, making all these changes, having their motherboard partners do it. It's going to take time and money. They're not going to want to do that again. They're going to be much more careful going forward, I think.
Yeah, and I just want to add, I think, I applaud the thing I'm applauding is the fact that you had a, fairly large company actually listen to its customer base. That's always good. You always want to go to the manager of McDonald's and have the manager of McDonald's say, oh, I'm sorry, here's your McNuggets, right? But I will say it's going to lead to a very messy, very ugly situation in the future where people get boards that just don't work. Somebody sells a used B450 board that will not work with lower end parts. And then you're going to get, I mean, I'm sorry, there's going to get people, you're going to get the folks that are going to go like, you know what? This, I expected this, it didn't work. I'm going to sue you now, right? It is the reason why AMD really very much decided they had to break it off was because it was just cleaner. And to not deal with it. And they're going to have to, it's going to be messy. They're going to have to deal with it. So it's bad news. Again, those are resources that you could put into making new chipsets, new CPUs, and all kinds of stuff. Instead, they're sitting there sending out CPUs to people who want to do their upgrade or something. So it's in some ways, it's like it would have been better as a financially to do an Intel. You know what? LJ1200, we might be able to run this in a socket. It might not work. We're not going to have things break. We're not going to get sued. We're going to go to something new, easy to know, 1200 parts, 1151 parts. You know what? Go your own way. Whereas this is like, oh yeah, we're, you know how sometimes you try to make everybody happy and you just end up making everybody pissed off. That's what I'm very afraid could happen. And then I really do hope in 2 years from now, AMD says, hey, you know what? Here are the results of our upgrade program, which we burned, I don't know, $3 million on. And you know how many people took advantage of this program to enable, these older motherboards? 3%, right?
It's not even going to be that
It won't even be that high, but I just
high.
hope that because everybody gets up in arms, we got it. I mean, it was just
Well,
heartbroken, which is I didn't want to get, on them, but I mean,
here's the thing. You sound a lot what you're saying sounds a lot like I was actually debating this with Josh Walrath from PC Perspective on Twitter, because he feels that, you know, this engineering resources would be better spent going towards new chipsets, new capabilities, which, yes, in a vacuum, I agree. But AMD's marketing promises, they painted themselves into this corner. I mean, they've been saying AM4 the whole time. I would have been fine with them saying Zen 3 won't be AM4. It'll be AM4 plus, like we talked about next show. And I mean, if they did that, it would still would have been AM4 through 2020 because it's 2020 now. But they've been saying, hey, you know, we're going to be supporting this. They didn't give anybody any warning 2 years ago when B450 came out that this is potentially a dead thing. They didn't give anybody any warning when Ryzen 3000 series chips came out last summer saying, hey, you know, B550 is not here. You can buy B450 now, but it's going to be a dead platform. If they had come out and said that flat out to people and gave people a warning, I'd be cool with it. I'm glad that they made this reversal. I know it's going to cost them money and effort and time, and that sucks, but I think it's the pro-consumer thing to do, and I'm glad to see it happen, even if it does mean less resources going to that future stuff.
So here's a question for you two, actually. Do you think they're actually going to burn more money on an upgrade program kind of thing, or do you think they would have burned more money by having alerted everyone in advance and then having all this all these B450 boards sitting because no one wanted to buy them because there was no path after?
You're buying into the internet conspiracy. That,
I'm not actually. I'm just curious. Like,
they misled us to sell us B450 boards.
I really don't think it was on purpose because no company wants to deal with this kind of crap. Like, it's just a mess. No, it's too sticky to want to bring that on yourself. But now we have this hindsight, I'm kind of wondering actually which way would have actually been financially worse for them, or like from our armchair perspectives here, obviously.
Brad.
I think it would have been fine. I think if they had just disclosed it when Zen 3 at least came out, or Ryzen 3000, the Zen 3 Ryzen 3000, you know, SKU messes up my brain sometimes. But when the, you know, the current Ryzen chips came out, if they had just said, look, B550 is coming, that's going to have a future, it has PCIe 4, it's not ready yet. In the meantime, you know, here's B450, you get the exact same performance except for storage, but we can't guarantee that it's going to upgrade. We're going to try to make it so it's upgradable next time. We can't guarantee that right now, and just been clear about it. I think I would have been A-okay with that. I think in general, you know, the internet probably would have been pretty okay with that. You would have got people complaining because people complain about everything, but I think AMD, like I said last time, is coming from they were coming in with good intentions and trying just to make the best of a complicated situation now.
Yeah.
And I definitely think it wouldn't have mattered if they'd come out and said B450 won't go forward. Come on. Most people buying a $650 Best Buy build, they're not thinking like, oh, I'm going to drop in Ryzen 4000. It's just not something. I don't think it would have mattered, but I also don't buy into anybody who thinks they knew when B450 came out that it was not forward compatible. I can't prove that. I'm not going to say that. That sort of really assumes a lot of they intentionally misled us kind of things. And, you know, I'm not going to say that. Nobody has any proof. Unless you have proof, don't say it. But I just don't generally believe they're going to, it would have been better not to say anything. You know, I just don't believe that. So, but yeah. I don't know.
I do think a really great look at this from a much broader perspective has been Steve's coverage over on Gamers Nexus, because he talks a lot about the used market and international markets and system integrators and all of that, which I think as enthusiasts sometimes you kind of lose track of the bigger picture because, you know, you're so passionate about your part of it. But it's a really good perspective check kind of thing.
No, I mean that's why when, you know, people say like, you know, I love upgrading. I think it's an awesome thing to do, but you know, very few people ever upgrade a CPU and a motherboard. They just don't over the entire thing. You know,
I agree with you. I agree with Josh, who I was talking about on Twitter. I agree with Steve from Gamers Nexus perspective of you got to look at this from the broader picture. I agree with all of that. However, personally, from my moral perspective, I think that I'm glad that they're doing this because they were leading customers to believe this B450 would not be a dead end and continue to be supported. So I'm glad to see them doing it.
Yeah.
I agree all the technical things. I agree everything that everyone says. I agree. I think they're doing it right by coming back and saying, actually, you know what? Yeah, we're going to support it. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
That said, Steve, Gamers Nexus, if you guys haven't seen it, anybody else, most of us probably have. He did 2 or 3 videos, and he goes into the technical reasons for this, like that we just glossed over here. We said, oh, there's technical reasons why they're doing this.
Yeah.
If you go follow that series, you'll get that great perspective about the wider market that Elena's talking about, as well as all those technical details and stuff. So if you want to deep dive, I think he did 3 videos. Definitely go check that out.
I think it's like the first one, I think, is marketing focus. The second is the technical focus. And then I think the one that went up today or yesterday is more about addressing AMD's like a reversal or partial reversal on the topic.
I just want to add that I love it that they listen to customers. Customers always right. I want my McDonald's McNuggets. There was only 8 in here. I ordered a 10 piece, whatever. But I just want people to not take advantage of it. I want people to not like, you know, oh my God, this program's terrible. It's got all these, you know, I have to do all this. And it's just like, but I know that's not going to happen. I know this program will come out. And instead of people saying, hey, at least you gave me a shot, it's going to be complaining and yelling and just all the normal things that always happen when you try to give that customer a 12-piece McNugget box to just get out of my McDonald's, people are still going to scream. They're still going to scream.
McDonald's.
It's going to disappoint me because I know it's going to happen, even though I think I'm with you, Brad. They did the right thing because they sort of convinced people to do it. But sometimes it makes me think, you know what? Just take your lumps now and move on. Because
it is a compromise.
It's a huge compromise.
They're going to be cutting out support for a bunch of older chips with these BIOSes. It's totally an optional thing for motherboard makers that are going to have to opt into. Hopefully, once, you know, 1 or 2 big ones do, the rest of them follow suit. But it's going to be up to your motherboard maker, your specific individual board. It's a compromise. There's a bunch of technical and marketing and all kinds of reasons for it. So hopefully people, you know, take that to heart. There are going to be people who complain, but hopefully the majority of the internet discourse could be, hey, it's a compromise. We're compromised as well. Everyone's doing the best they can.
Yeah. I'm forecasting a class action lawsuit because I bought my B450 board on eBay and it didn't work. And then it's going to be a mess. It's going to be a mess. But you know what, internet? We're entering this mess because of you. So
we're entering this mess because of AMD marketing.
I guess
I don't agree with you putting it on people. See, that's I think our fundamental difference.
We're Brad, when you see the people that are complaining about like, well, I ordered a 10-piece nugget. I want 2 Big Macs. Like, why would I give you 2 Big Macs when you ordered a 10-piece and you got shorted 1? You don't deserve 2 Big Macs.
I'm not trying to be a peacekeeper here, but I honestly think you're both right. Seriously. Yeah. Like, I really think it's true that AMD could have said it better, and because of that, the internet got upset, you know? So it's both things all happy at the same time.
So, Elena, how would you get us out of your McDonald's? You're the manager. I saw it. It said 10-piece nugget. I got 9-piece. I want something. You need to fix this right now.
Whenever I have an issue, they give me extra. Like if I go, hey, I only got 7 in this McNugget, then they just give me, hey, here's a whole another 10. They don't give me 2 nuggets. They give me a whole another thing.
Yes.
Yeah, it's either that or you give them a coupon to come back later when they're less angry.
I'm just saying because what happens is people, they don't want their 1 nugget. They want their 10 nuggets. And then they want a Filet-O-Fish too. Then they want the Filet-O-Fish and apple pie. So that's going to happen.
We always have customers like that too. It's an unfortunate part of working in food service or retail.
Well,
it is getting up on 5 o'clock here, and all this McNugget talk is making me incredibly hungry.
Yeah,
that isn't a hint that I want to rush. That's just this McNugget. McNuggets are my Achilles heel. I could eat them by the truckload.
Sour sauce.
I get McDonald's notifications on my phone all the time. They taunt me. We haven't seen you in a while.
All right, yeah, we should get on to some questions.
Q&A.
Yeah, if you have your questions, get them in the folder Discord, link in the description. We have a channel in there. You can put in the questions at any time of the week, and we'll get to them on the show. That's kind of the best way to get them in. So the first one comes in from me. A little bit of breaking news. It just announced, Mark Hawkman has a story on PC World that Intel has purchased the manufacturers of the killer networking services. Gordon, what does that mean?
So killer, the ancient history is it goes back to they made a network accelerated card with a hardware accelerator. They promised lower latency. They had really, really bad runs of drivers and application support. People got very angry and upset, sort of went away. It came back. Now people still think of killer as really poor because they think of the 10-year ago or 15-year ago killer. Today, killer parts are basically based on Intel parts. So it's basically an Intel part. And what they're saying is, you know what? We are paying attention to the software stack, so we're going to get you better software. For the most part, a lot of Dells come with the killer software with Intel hardware. I'm going to guess Intel is going to buy them because they want to market gaming and they want to market. They do want the access to that software team from Killer. I don't know if it's going to work out. Killer again has been bought and sold by other people. They had a bad streak, but most part lately been pretty good. I myself had in the old days had to change the Killer NIC in a laptop because it wasn't great. I put in an Intel card. Those days are long gone. They actually use Intel hardware. So yeah, no, it's hard to come back from that, but they have.
I think it's a smart move, seeing as how they've been pushing the gaming angle so hard to, you know, double down on killer networking as well to go with it. It especially because it's been gaming and Wi-Fi 6 and connectivity they've been, you know, playing up recently. So I think it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's cool stuff. They have a lot of sort of gaming and enthusiast-oriented features. You just don't get that in a stock Intel driver or utility. So this really, it's got a lot of promise. And again, let me say this again, it's not the old killer hardware. This is basically Intel hardware with the killer software, which I haven't heard any complaints about lately. So
could be good. Does that mean that they're not going to show up on AMD laptops?
No. In fact, the Asus G14, the ROG Zephyrus G14, that has an Intel NIC in it. I have seen many Intel laptops with Intel NICs. Intel, they sell hardware. They charge you for the hardware. They want to sell more. It doesn't mean we're going to keep it for ourselves. They're going to want to sell AMD this stuff because they're selling them something. They don't care. Money's money.
Unless it's Thunderbolt 3.
That is a lot more complicated.
No, I know.
No, yeah.
Okay, cool. Like I said, more information over on PCWorld.com. I just put the link in the chat. Mark,
I haven't even read it yet.
Yeah, Mark's following that. So, thank you, Mark. We got a question a while ago that I've been holding on to from Yak Superman on Twitch. He said, which laptop is better, the MSI GS66 or the Razer Blade 15 2020 with the 2080 Ti with the 300 hertz refresh? I guess they both have that. Is that what it is?
Yeah, they're actually very close in specs. It's hard to say. I haven't seen the Razer Blade. I'm still in the middle of testing the GS66. I still have some reservations. I don't think it's necessarily about the platform. I think it's about what's inside. I'm not really sure 2080 Ti and i9 8-core part is enough. That's like chewing off a little too much hardware for a 15.6-inch laptop. I think 9750, you know, 10750 with 2070 Super Max Q is probably the right place to be for that size. I'd have to see both. But again, 300 hertz panel, that GS66 is pretty sweet. I mean, it's a nice laptop, but you get to that high-end config and the thermals might be an issue.
I love that 300 hertz panels are now a thing with the new 2070 and 2080 Super. There's like so many more 300 hertz panels. And that's great because I know marketing likes to talk about 4K panels. I hate 4K panels in laptops because the things get too squished. It kills your battery life. I really think 1080p, maybe 1440p, although that's super rare, is the ideal place to be in a laptop. So to be able to pair a 2080 Super with a 300 hertz 1080p laptop screen. I just love that that's a thing now, because that's the ideal gaming laptop. I mean, much different than the 4K panels that they have been pushing down everybody's throats.
Adam will probably differ on that. He'd probably want the 4K, I'm thinking, for the...
Well, yeah, he's a content creator, so...
Yeah, and I will say the high refresh does make a difference, as we've proved to ourselves.
I'm going to slip in real quick, because I don't know if we actually already thanked people, Adam, so if we already did it, let me know, but I just wanted to do shout-outs to people who left us a couple super chats earlier in the show.
Oh, yes, I think I forgot, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Eskamonster with another 20 Danish Krone, thank you for that, appreciate it.
Thank you.
And then LaSalle Rhymes the Third did a drive-by with $5, thank you, says, looking forward to hearing today's topics tonight after they get off of work, so... Just want to make sure those people got acknowledgement.
Nice.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
So next question, we just got in chat from Mike Chang. This is kind of an interesting one. With the recent news about TSMC no longer manufacturing for Huawei, which was their second largest customer after Apple, due to U.S. government blacklisting, will that speed up release date of Ampere cards if NVIDIA moves to buy up all the available wafer capacity that's not available from the previous Huawei orders?
It could, if that, you know, realistic, if that actually stops happening, like they shut down this line, they're not making any more, et cetera, et cetera. This is all very big multinational, you know, political kind of things going on. I wouldn't try to forecast it too much from a technology standpoint, but if in fact that does happen, then yes, you would think that it would, you know, if you have open lines, it'd be easier to crank out more parts faster. So makes sense. But again, I'm not trying to forecast geopolitical chip wars.
Yeah, and then also I wouldn't assume that NVIDIA would get to go to the front of the line, because there's just a company called Apple that might just...
And like, AMD. Hey, AMD's bought a lot of it.
We'll take everything you got, you know, so.
Yep, good point. All right, over on Discord, back to the AMD talk. This one's a stick with me here. The way it's written is a little complex. Boria Zero said, what are the chances of AMD supporting the first three iterations of Ryzen CPUs on AM5 on the same motherboard, like happened with 300 series motherboards and Zen, Zen Plus, and Zen 2? Technically, it should be easier because BIOS ROM will be big enough from the start. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but makes I don't sense. Think they'll do that. I don't think they'll do that. We're talking about AM5? No.
I don't think it's going to happen after all this, especially. I think they're going to rein back their expectations a whole lot. I wouldn't be surprised if they try to do maybe 3 years of upgrades or something like that, or three generations of upgrades, just to be out ahead of Intel still. But I think they're really going to start reining back expectations about backwards compatibility.
Yeah, and it also really doesn't. It's, you know, they sort of had to play that game before, because, you know, the AMD brand Ryzen hadn't been established. I would think with AM5, they could very much be more like Intel in a lot of ways, and, you know, kind of keep everything in one bin. And also, you also have to realize it's really cool to be able to run old hardware with new motherboards and all this sort of backwards compatibility stuff, but it can also drag you back. Like, what if they had to make compromises for AM5 in order to support a Ryzen 2000 part? Would you be happy with that? I wouldn't be. I would want any AM5 to push forward, to go forward, and not worry about somebody, some cheapskate, sorry, Elena, buying some old CPU and then jamming it into an AM5 board. It's just not something they should be looking at. They should be looking at competing with Intel on performance.
I thought the PC was open to all. That's all.
It is. It is. And you know what? There's, we, in memory transitions, we had boards, they would go like, hey, it's DDR and DDR2. How does that work? Oh, like horribly. It works horribly. Right? You would just like, you had like, oh, and we have a socket converter. How does it well? Well, it doesn't work well at all. It's just terrible. It's all a compromise. Those compromises can just drag everything down. Or like, hey, remember when Intel used to give you 2 SATA 6 ports and 4 SATA 3, right? And they would say like, oh, we did that because we didn't want board manufacturers to have to relay out the boards, right? In the end, you basically got this motherboard that had 2 SATA 600 and force out of 300 because supposedly to save money and to help support, you know, it's like, you know what? You should have just done all SATA 6 and just said tough, you know?
Yep.
No, I completely agree. I just think it's funny just trying to put those two statements of yours together sometimes. When you're like, on one hand, you're like, PC's open to all of them. It's like, push them overboard.
No, because you can't, you know, you can't, it is, you can't also move at the slowest pace, right?
I know.
You gotta, there's a point where you're going to drop off. It's a bummer. I think, frankly, PC's very reasonable. It's not like Apple. Like they threw 32-bit app support in that latest OS out. You're screwed. You have Office. You know, it's perfectly fine. You have an 8-year-old version of Office that works fine. You have to buy a new one now. If you did that on PC, Microsoft should get credit for that. If you did it on PC, people would go up there with pitchforks. If you broke 32-bit ancient installs of PC on PC, people would be like, no. Apple does it all day, and people are like, oh, I think 4 years is plenty of warning. That's what the response was from one Apple person, right? It's just like, what? Sorry.
Also, 64 is bigger than 32. Why wouldn't you want the bigger number, Gordon?
Just see, that's the difference. It's open, but it doesn't mean, you know, come on. There's, and hell, you can run stuff from the earliest days of Windows and on current Windows 10. So.
All right. A couple more questions, then we'll get out of here. Scorpio896 has a really tough question. They say they have 60 pounds, I think it is. I just looked it up. It's about $75 US dollars budget for headphones, and they really just need them for voice recording and listening. Which ones are the best ones? That's a hard price range, you know, if you're looking for the best on that end. They say they don't need it for gaming, but, you know, obviously open to gaming headphones if it's an option. Yeah, I know. Hayden's recommendation at the low end of gaming headphones is the Cloud Alpha, right?
Yeah, the Cloud, yep. HyperX.
The HyperX Cloud Alpha, yeah. I just looked on, you know, some of the professional audio headsets. It's just hard. Especially at that price range.
Is there really anything on the professional side in that price range that it's a headset and not headphones? Because I feel like in that price range, you're really looking more at like gaming-focused consumer-type headsets.
There are some, yeah. The problem is not just quality, but also comfort, too. A lot of them have the smaller drivers, so they sit on your ear rather than over your ear. And me personally, I don't like that. Yeah, and somebody's at least saying that the mic on the Cloud Alphas are not that great. So you're kind of it's hard to get both, especially for that. I mean, the places I always kind of look at is, you know, the Sony has some headsets, Sennheiser's I've always been a big fan of, but I
want to look into SteelSeries as well if we're doing anything gaming related.
Yeah,
Depends. It really depends too, though, because people have really different preferences and what they think is a good mic versus not a good mic after a certain point. I mean, obviously, once you get past like stuff like I can't pronounce that today.
Sibilance.
Thank you. and all that stuff. It's just then like some people think that this is too tinny. Some people think this is too, you know, lows focus. So I'd also just might have to read some reviews and see what the reactions are and what the complaints are specifically about the mic and see what you're willing to sacrifice given the price range. Like, you're not going to be able to get like all the best things for that price.
What about going for a lower end capsule mic, just USB, and then just using whatever headset jack you've got, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's
the audio, the recording is the critical part, I think, sometimes.
Yeah, honestly, I don't know. I wouldn't know.
Maybe there's a reasonable use market on you know.
Yeah. I mean, really nice high end microphones and headphones. You know, can, if they're treated well, can hold their value. That's for sure.
Yeah.
There's some good recommendations in the chat. I'm kind of looking up some of these. But yeah, I just personally don't have any experience that I can talk to. So sorry about that. And then over on Discord, here's an interesting one from CMoney619. Why is it cheaper for me to order parts from outside the U.S. and have them shipped in versus buying them in the U.S.?
You know, I saw that question, but I didn't have enough time to start researching that myself. So shooting completely from the hip and not having done any research, so like gigantic boulder of salt here. My guess is that something, I mean, the tariffs, we're talking about US, right? So the tariffs might be playing a factor in it. Also just how the supply chains are working right now in terms of shipments arriving. So it could be that, like, I was actually watching one of PC Welt, our German sister site, one of their videos, and they were talking about prices for, I think, power supplies, and I could not get over how cheap it sounded compared to what they've been here. And I do think it has something to do partially with, at least the tariffs, if not other just global pandemic related supply chain type things.
And also, I mean, if you're talking about shipping versus retail, like retail space and warehouse space and retail stores is much more expensive than someone buying a container ship full of boxes and boxes and boxes of headsets. So it could just be economies of scale.
Yeah, and also different markets too. Although I will say CPU prices, RAM, SSDs, they tend to be very fixed. I was very sad to see prices in Taiwan of CPUs, for example. They're basically the same as here. But maybe other components, like maybe a case being sold in a different part of the world, is just not going to be as much as a case here. So, and you are supposed to report things you buy, I think, overseas, but nobody ever does, right?
Also,
No.
somebody says gray market, is kind of a way to get certain items, as well. But yeah.
But there's no US warranty usually attached to that too, so
Exactly.
you're gambling with that.
Yep. And last question from Rare. I think it's actually kind of a fun one. Assuming we're going to have more digital-only product announcements this year, I just realized Computex would have been at the end of this month, right?
Next week, this week. Yeah, it was going to be something like that. Yeah,
Yeah.
next week.
Oh man. And then E3 was next month. Just all these. Yeah, it's a
Yep.
bummer. It says, is it possible to have somebody from the Full Nerd do a live reaction watch party? Or is it more important to get your notes article together during a presentation so that you can post it as soon as possible? Good question.
It depends if we're pre-briefed or not. And for a lot of these, we actually get pre-briefed. So we know it's coming before you guys do. They get all the press together and say, hey, here's what's coming. So we all have time to work on our articles and dissect it and analyze it and put out the news. And in that case, I mean, we're all just watching the events anyway. But for a lot of the big digital live events, I'd say it's about 50-50. A lot of them, you don't get pre-briefed. They just say, hey, watch the video. So it depends.
Yeah, we've done it in the past for a couple
We
things,
have.
but usually we're at the event, so, I think obviously we're more open to it now. There are some
Yeah.
logistical problems, with taking the stream and, having us put our reactions over it as well. But I mean, generally, when we can do it, I think it's fun.
Yeah. We did it for the RTX launch, if I remember right.
I've never
And
actually been on one of those.
Yeah,
yeah.
it's fun. We should
Super
totally
fun.
do it. We should
We should
totally do
totally
it.
do
Done it
it.
for Apple
Absolutely.
launches.
Yeah,
Remember
Apple
we did
launch we
that
did done
Apple
for
Bingo?
sure.
We did iBingo. That was fun.
Yeah, that was fun. But cool. Yeah, look out for that. And also look out later this week. We have Frank Azor from AMD coming on the show. We have a special edition at 10:30 a.m. Pacific time this Friday, which is the 22nd. Yes, 22nd. I got it right. So if you got questions for him, put them in the Discord. Mostly talking about laptop stuff in there, but he does obviously work at AMD, so we can ask him whatever we want, but doesn't necessarily mean he's gonna
Gonna
talk
answer.
to it,
He's
deeply.
their chief gaming officer, I believe, right?
That's a good question. I actually don't know
Something
his official
like that.
title.
It's I think it's that. So yeah, if you have any gaming questions.
Yeah, and Frank Azor, for people who don't know, was one of the co-founders of Alienware, correct, Gordon?
Yeah, he goes all the way back to he is as OG as most OG people in
He's a
PC
really
gaming.
good interview too. Like he'll talk legit with you too.
I just like asking him stuff like, who does AMD like more, consoles or gaming PCs? And Frank will be like,
Chief, He's the chief architect of gaming solutions.
We love them all. We love everybody because everybody is paying us money. So we love everybody. You think I'm going to trash talk consoles? He's not going to do it. He won't do it.
Yeah, that's your job.
Yes. Just for fun. It's just fun. We're just having fun here.
That's so fun. All right. Why don't you take us out of here? Brad's got to go get some McDonald's. And also somebody pointed out that we got our sponsorship money for the week. For bringing up McDonald's.
I'm going to need me a nice 20 piece.
I only got 18 in this 20 piece.
20 piece McNugget. I remember going through a drive through with a coworker and like, do you have 20 piece nugget? Like, no, we don't have 20 piece. What? He's like, yeah, no, we don't have 20 piece. Do you have 10 piece? Yeah. Can you just put two of those in the box? But it was weird. It was like, what? Yeah. It's on the menu. It's 20 piece nuggets. It's been here forever.
Maybe they ran out of boxes.
I was confused, but like, yeah.
That's okay. Funny.
Check back next week for your fix of...
Check back Friday.
Check back Friday for your fix of PC Talk on the Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or Stitcher. And also, please leave a review. Every time you do, somebody gets an extra Chicken McNugget in their box of 20-piece nuggets. Send questions and comments to thefullnerd@pcworld.com. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Brad Charkas.
Get me out of the sun.
Elena Yee.
Bye, everyone.
And Adam Patrick Murray is putting in our McDonald's order.
I'm actually going to skip on the McDonald's. I'm going to Burger King anyway.
What?
See everybody. Bye.